Mystery Science Theater has been around for about 30 years now. Because of them, we have seen those movies of the past in a different way. We have seen some classics and a lot of stink bombs through the eyes of Joel, Mike, and now Jonah and the bots in a way you and I can watch them more entertainingly. There are a few films that, however, I think slip through the cracks that I like. The stories in theory are not that bad. Some are worth mentioning and need to be examined without riffs. I admit, a lot of the acting can be bad and the special effects are extremely bad sometimes, but even a movie with great effects does not make it good. Here are some movies I could watch without riffs and I kinda enjoy. I am no way against the riffing of the films. Heck, if it wasn't for MSt3k, I would have never known about these films. The Hellcats. The Hellcats was an Anthony Cardoza and Ross Hagen attempt at a biker film slash action film. In the 80s and the 70s, we would see this premise on television several times. The action blockbuster films were right around the corner with Billy Jack and many other action stars that were coming later. Steven Seagal, Chuck Norris, and Van Damme, and many others, were not around. But until then, we had Ross Hagen. Now, I'm not a big fan of biker films, but there have been action films later that would copy the Hellcats premise. This film, as terrible as some of the characters are in it, I do not hate them. The worst character is our main villain, who really we could do without. He is your typical distasteful lower mob guy. He is bland. And as far as Ross and the gang, they are very likable. I cannot hate them. I found many of the characters charismatic, and I want to root for them. Side hackers. Okay, I admit it. I kind of like Ross Hagen during this period. I think when Ross Hagen started doing the Wonder Woman film, things got bad for Ross. Side hackers was one of the earlier revenge flicks at the time of the modern era of revenge flicks, which started obviously with westerns and samurai flicks. As time went on, westerns became less cool, and so the revenge idea stayed in the mind of writers. There are probably many revenge films meant to be westerns that went on to the revenge cop film or so forth. The biggest problem with this film is the name itself, Side Hackers. The whole revenge story is the champion of the movie. This is why you need to watch it one time at least without Joel and the bots. Okay, let's admit it. You need to fast forward through all the side hacking scenes because of the latter emphasis on side hacking. This Ross Hagen film has been called also by another name called Five the Hard Way. I like that name better. With that, you can hear the old Western revenge emphasis. Okay, this is where MSt3k started editing movies, and it actually hurt this film by editing an important part of the film. We are introduced in this film by some great characters. We as an audience love that Ross is in love. He wants to settle down. He wants to live a normal life, but he meets JC. Okay, I cannot remember the villain in Hellcats, but I sure know who JC is. JC is portrayed by actor Michael Pataki. Pataki, who would go on to play Captain Barbera in the TV movie adaptation of Spider-Man. His performance of JC is great. He is the villain we all want. The film allows JC some likability, but at the same time, even though JC is deceived, he still is dirty enough for us to root for Ross. The edited scene that MSt3k cut out could have caused many to be confused from a movie with a confusing title. We, the audience, need to know why Ross is angry, and the edited scene that MSt3k eventually cut out let us, the viewer, know why Ross is mad. The ending of Side Hackers is unexpected and gives us, the viewers, a question of whether or not what Ross did was right or wrong. The ending does take me back to those old revenge westerns of the past. Hercules. Oh, come on. It is a classic Steve Reeves Hercules. You have to watch it. If you're a fan of cinema without the riffs, at least one time. This film introduced Hercules to many actors and changed the face of the male action star who was mainly known for westerns. The Girl in Lover's Lane. I like this film for very few reasons, obviously. Our characters are kind of corny. I like this film for Jack Elam. I like it also because it is very nostalgic. I know cinema is fiction, but I would like to know how real Train Town was. We get a glimpse of railroad towns through maybe Petticoat Junction, but at one time the railroad ruled. You see, a railroad town meant something at one time. Later on, as gas-powered vehicles became more affordable, railroad towns became less profitable and crime went up. Obviously, the town in Lover's Lane has been cursed by progression and decreasing of the railroad industry. In fact, we see our characters leave town through the means of a delivery truck. Could this be a telling of the sad state of the railroad industry? Obviously, the truck picked up the delivery in town where the delivery train stopped. I know that one man's heaven is another man's hell. Our protagonist is faced with being beat up, prostitution and drinking, and many vices, but nowhere is the police to be found. Now, for some, this might be hell. To others who hate the thought of totalitarian government, this could be heaven. Biggs survives because he is strong. In one scene, our runaway wants to know why they have to fight. And Biggs' response is because that's the way it is. We find out that Biggs and the runaway have both given up and that they may need to fight for family and relationships, just like fighting thugs and other things in life. I like the thought of the police being more of peacekeepers than being the uncontrollable power we have given them today. The job of these peacemakers are to keep the peace or keep you alive until the trial. I think this is a film you need to watch without the riffs. I like Gunslinger, but for all of its plot holes, for all of its silliness, and Roger Corman's poor directing, this film is likable and tolerable. One reason is like the premise. I think if a modern actress, maybe an Angelina Jolie type, could make this film and maybe make it right as a remake. I think the second reason I like this film is that John Ireland and Beverly Garland are so darn likable. I don't know, maybe John Ireland is completely drunk on the set, and maybe Beverly Garland didn't want to be there according to Roger Corman's book. But they are likable. John Ireland plays this rough bad guy, and Beverly Garland plays this charismatic but tough-talking temporary sheriff who is believable enough to be the good girl to make a bad man good. In the climactic ending shootout scene between Garland and Ireland, we hear Ireland asking Garland if it's both ways. And we know what that means. This scene is very emotional, and I believe Garland hates what she has to do, which is arrest John Ireland or kill him. This is obviously one of the worst westerns of all time, but it is sure fun to watch. Mitchell. Okay, obviously there's not much love between Joe Don Baker and MSt3k, and I can see why. If you watch the Mitchell MSt3k version, you would immediately dismiss Mitchell as a bad film. I have also perceived that as well, but in this case, until I saw the R-rated uncensored movie cut version, when I watched the R-rated cut movie version, it actually made sense. Mitchell did, the movie. It is obviously an action film of that time, but also a bit of noir as well. Mitchell is dealing with two really bad people who are connected to one mobster, which is not clear in the MST3K version. The dune buggy scene between Mitchell and John Saxon is cut out in the MST3K version, but is actually a good scene and is fun to watch. I believe the confusion about the film is not all on MST3K, but on the version that was given to MST3K at the time, which was the 1980 TV version, which was heavily edited, which caused a lot of confusion. Dirty Harry, which was a very violent movie and was on the people's mind at the time that Mitchell was released, the audience of Dirty Harry type films expected R-rated violence and sex, in which Mitchell successfully delivers. If you want to compare Mitchell with Dirty Harry, it is no Dirty Harry. But it is a B version of Dirty Harry, and it does deliver a cheaper Dirty Harry. I, however, like more the noir factor of Mitchell, which I think makes it a good film. The action is really secondary. Parts, the Clonus Horror. I saw Parts, if you will, before the MST3K version, and I find it just as good as any Canadian horror film at the time. If you want to compare with Rapid or all the Canadian horror films, I know the main character is not likable in Parts, of course, but the idea itself is really good. In fact, that it was good enough that the island decided ripping it off. the clone story and everything. Because of MSt3k, we have a legitimate court case where we see a strong case of copyright infringement against the island. We have to remember that cloning in the 70s was a big subject, and many shows and movies talked about it, but later on, healthcare came on the table, and we get the island, which included the whole concept of the healthcare and cloning debate because of, hey, Dolly the Sheep. We might want to thank MSt3k for bringing the film to light, which helped lead to the lawsuit, but we might want to remember that maybe the film came to the knowledge of DreamWorks through MSt3k, you know, sort of circular reasoning. Either way, the concept is not a bad one, but just maybe the delivery was bad. The budget for Clonus was around $257,000. Star Wars 2 years earlier budget was $11 million. What would Clonus be like with a bigger budget? Who knows? Maybe the island. The Rebel set. I love the Rebel set. And why I love the Rebel set? Because you can apply the story of the Rebel set to any delusioned generation, from the beat set to the punk set to the hippie set, the goth set, heck, even the emo set. The bottom line is young men need a purpose, and idle hands are the devil's plaything. I notice when I stop doing things such as doing a YouTube script, I am more likely to do things I shouldn't do. I love this movie. A plot unfortunately falls apart towards the end. I mostly like Edward Platt, who went on to the Get Smart TV series. He has a speech which sums up the entire movie. He tells our young people that they are not detached, they are unemployed and scared. These young people probably did not hear this from their parents the same way my parents did not say that either. I think it says this is one of many reasons why young people get into crime. They need a purpose and a way, and even if it is a wrong way, it is still a way. Okay, that was my list of MSt3k movies that I like and could watch without riffs, and maybe there are more, so tell me more MSt3k movies you can watch without Joel, Mike, Jonah, or the bots in the comment section below. And do not forget to like, subscribe, and share.